First of all, thank you all for being here, and I'm very glad to be back. I feel like an old customer in an old pub, even though the surroundings are much more beautiful than the pubs which I usually go to. Thank you, Chantal, thank you, Jess, for inviting me, and I must warn you that as it has happened in the past, once more, when I started putting together my thought in order to prepare the presentation, I realized that I had too many things to say, so I tried to squeeze as much as I could in one presentation, but I think that we need to have a second part of this conference in the coming future. So, already last year I spoke about big data, data science, and I feel obliged to explain you a little the background. As many of you know, I used to be an astrophysicist, and almost 20 years ago now, together with George Orgoski, we slowly drifted toward Curious George. It's a we slowly drifted toward the data science because the amount of data which were collected by the new instruments was so large and so impressive that there was no way to handle it with the traditional tools. And we began to explore the possibilities to use innovative software based on machine learning to ease the reduction, analysis, and understanding of these new data sets. So I became more and more involved in data science, and since 2 years I am chairing the data science initiative of my university, and I have changed profession. I am no longer an astrophysicist, and to tell you the truth, I frankly don't know what I am now. I mean, I'm somewhere in the middle between different disciplines. Mainly, I'm interacting with engineers, companies, and I'm building a new know-how on what's happening around us. And therefore, even with respect to my last presentation here in Second Life, much has changed, at least in my understanding of the topic and of the field. And this presentation, and if we succeed in organizing it, also the second one, will be about taking away a little of the drama which has been mounting in the last 2 years around the topic of artificial intelligence. There is a hype around us about artificial intelligence. You know better than me that wherever you go now, you have artificial intelligence advertised. I mean, you go to a supermarket and you find that the items were selected for you by an artificial intelligence algorithm. You go out, you buy a car with artificial intelligence. You go out with, you take a plane and they tell you that the seat assignment is done with artificial intelligence and so on. Artificial intelligence, in my opinion, is just a buzzword. You know, one of those words which periodically are used by community, by journalists, politicians, in order to signal that there is something incredibly new happening. I'm not saying that there is nothing new happening. I mean, actually, we are in the epicenter of a revolution which deeply affects the way we live and the way we work, the way we organize our lives. But from this to artificial intelligence, I mean, there is still a lot to come. So, I mean, there is a lot. There are many considerations. At the moment, I'm writing a book on the topic. So, you know, there is the My thoughts have not yet reached the sort of crystallized form, so there is still a magma of ideas which come back and forward, and therefore I'm quite sure that in the second part of my talk I will say something which will be in slight disagreement with what I'm saying now, but I mean, this is science, this is, you know, evolution of understanding and evolution of thought. The data science, as it's so shown on the slide, is something very simple. It's a set of principles, problems, definitions, algorithms, and the processes which focus on extracting non-obvious and useful patterns from large data sets. Data science extracts patterns, not knowledge. Knowledge, which is, say, can be assimilated to understanding, is something different. I mean, at the moment, we are still far from having an understanding performed by some artificial device. I mean, knowledge and understanding are still a human, right? A human, you know, characteristics. I mean, so that's, and data science basically is what artificial intelligence is all about. So it's what I'm going to say for data science, also for artificial intelligence. Our wisdom, Ariane, how about the wisdom? I mean, yeah. But the problem is that wisdom is a problem for natural intelligence, not a, not a future problem for artificial intelligence. I mean, so basically, the layman understanding of artificial intelligence comes out of science fiction books and science fiction movies. And this is also why I think this buzzword has become so popular, because artificial intelligence carries with it, you know, bad feelings. I mean, it is a scary term. I mean, people are scared by the idea that one day some sort of Terminator or, you know, malevolent evil machine, you know, will try to exterminate a human being. I mean, this is a common understanding. If you ask 100 people in the streets, 95% of them will tell you that artificial intelligence will mean the end of the human race. Also because the idea of artificial intelligence makes humans feel irrelevant in some sense, because if you think about it, I mean, so far all the progress in our technology has concerned only one aspect of the human being, the homo faber, the Latin Romans will say. The man as maker of tools, the man as maker of stuff. The Industrial Revolution was a revolution about capability to make things. The revolution which we have experienced at the beginning of this century was also the same, the technological revolution, the industrial revolution. Everything was about the capability of humans to make handicraft, to make new tools, new instruments. For the first time, we are with artificial intelligence, we are facing a revolution which affects the Homo sapiens, so the capability of human beings think and understand. And this is something very scary. This is something we have never dealt with before, and for which we have no antibodies. Basically, we don't know how to react, how to adjust ourselves to such a revolution. And therefore, there are huge social, religious, philosophical topics which are under discussion. I mean, even legal topics. And there is a huge discussion going on everywhere, more or less in every community. This was a pleasant discovery. Before starting the large amount of research, I thought that artificial intelligence was a topic discussed mainly by computer scientists and mathematicians and by data scientists. This is not true at all. There is a huge community covering all aspects of human thought, which is discussing the topic, from lawyers to judges to theologians to experts of human science, psychologists, and so on. There is a huge literature, far larger than any human being will ever be able to grasp, you know, in a normal lifetime. It's a very active, a very vibrant, very exciting field in this moment. But basically, we are discussing of the sex of the angels. Intelligence is still far to come. But people are so scared by what it could be that there is a lot of discussion about how to deal with artificial intelligence machines, which are not yet here. And there is a lot of confusion, and I think it's important to clarify this confusion. In all the groups of people I've mentioned before, because they mess up with between artificial intelligence and wrong use of big data and of algorithmic capability to use this data in order to predict trends, to control trends, and, you know, to manipulate the society around us. So here we are. The real meaning, therefore, is that artificial intelligence is nothing else that a collection of different programs which try to address specific, simple, specific problems. So basically, the approach is I isolate a specific process hidden within human thinking, like, for instance, how do I visualize a vertical structure? How do I visualize a cat? And how I recognize that it is a cat rather than a dog, and so on. Then, first you isolate the process, then you transform it into algorithms, and this is usually the most difficult part, and then you run it on computers. And then, if you are successful, you start using these algorithms to substitute humans who perform repetitive tasks of the same type. For instance, already now in the United States, after the success of the automatic driving cars and trucks, now there is already a community which is scared of losing relevance, like, for instance, truck drivers, who have understood that within, let's say, 5 years, 10 years, most of them will be out of a job just because automatic driven trucks will do the same job more effectively, less costly, and way. So, I mean, I'm not saying that this algorithmic approach to problem solution, pattern finding, is not impacting our society. It is impacting it a lot, and it will even more impact on our way of life in the coming future, I mean, the most unexpected way. Also, because once you learn how to do the trick on one task, to export it to other tasks is much easier. You already know how to do it, you just need to do some bit of fine-tuning. Let me change the slide, I always get confused with the controls. I apologize for that. Okay, should work. Yeah. One thing which I found very refreshing is that at some point I decided to understand why suddenly, 2-3 years ago, artificial intelligence seemed to emerge outside of nowhere, just popped out suddenly. In this world, if you look to statistics of the usage of the word of artificial intelligence in in non-science fiction literature, you find that there is really a discontinuity before 2016, half of 2015 and immediately after, because the number of times these words appeared increased by factor 100. And this is always very suspicious. When something suddenly becomes, you know, immensely popular, in Italy we say it doesn't smell right. So the first thing I wanted to understand is whether this thing was really something new or was just a new cover on something very much older. And I did as I always do when I am interested in a new problem. I went back to the literature and tried to reconstruct a little history, and I realized that actually there is nothing very new. It's what we call nowadays artificial intelligence, which for me is more or less a synonymous of data science, is something very old. It appeared very, very long time ago from the fusion of two trends which have been around since the very early stage of human evolution, data collection and data analysis. Because basically we are doing just with computers something which has always been done. It's nothing new. Data collection is as old as the human civilization, and the type of data are always the same. Already in the third millennium before Christ, there were transactional data, which means basically data about economic transaction. I sell you a camel and I get so many cows, and this type of things were already stored in some form, as well as non-transactional data, so data which were not related to economic transaction. For instance, the Roman and the Egyptian census were and it was always a sort of transaction, because in the end they wanted to tax people in a more effective way, so it always money was involved. But basically, these censuses were built collecting words, collecting information about words, sex, and this type of things. All these data were collected in common storage, so the collection of data is a very old thing. And the next step, it has the capability to retrieve data in an organized way, what we would call today structured data, is at least as old as the Library of Alexandria in Christ. So, I mean, basically the analogic version of a database. And this thing, therefore, since data collection is so old, you know, it's very likely that also data analysis is a little younger. I mean, algorithms and simple tools to analyze and extract information from the data are at least as old. Here you have an example where you have the data analyst of the Egyptian time, which were the scribes, you know, checking the census information, applying mathematical formulas, you know, in order to derive taxes. So, I mean, these things have been around for a long, long time, and their relevance increased as the society became more and more complex. One big difference, this is a slide from my old presentation, is that in the past to collect the data was a quite expensive and quite lengthy procedure. Therefore, the baud rate, the number of data which you could collect per unit of time, was very, very low. Well, nowadays we are surrounded by digital sensor, by every aspect of our life is subject. Every time we use a card, every time we file an email, we send a Twitter, we post something on the social networks, but you know, every time we buy something, this information is automatically stored. So basically, data collection has become a very inexpensive thing. And the amount of data which is produced is just very, very large. Incredibly large. The turning point, which where everything which we nowadays call data science started, is in 1991, when, which is quite a long time ago. It's when this guy here, Edgar Codd, he was born in 1923, in 2003, laid down the foundation of the so-called, what we call nowadays, the relational database. This guy was a quite amazing scientist. He won the famous Turing Prize, which was, is a sort of Nobel for computer science. He is also the man who invented the term online analytical processing, which is well known as OLAP nowadays. And what is more important, he codified the analytical processing, which is the bottom of everything we are doing nowadays, which is 12 laws which must be followed in order to perform online data processing. It is nice to say that at the time he was a researcher for IBM, and when he published this paper, Relational Model of Data for Large Shared Data Banks, put it in the slide, IBM didn't consider it at all. I mean, it just didn't take into account. And Codd published it through third party, let's say, basically a paper which was sponsored by Arbor Software, later became Hyperion, and now it's a part of Oracle. And this is one of the many mistakes which IBM has done, despite of many good things they've done, but IBM has done a lot of mistakes, because the guy who instead understood the potentiality of Codd's paper was Ellison. He's the founder of Oracle, and now he's the eighth richest man in the world. He basically, at the time the paper by Codd came out, he was working for CIA, building the first database based on Codd's principle for CIA. But when he understood the potentialities, he just went out, quitted from CIA, and established the company, which was after the laboratory, which in 1982 became Oracle, which actually, in this moment, is the monopolist of relational database all over the world. Also, they established the standard query language, which is data, relational database. I mean, this is important because it begins to tell you that what matters is who controls the data and how they control it. But we'll go back to that, to this later on. The second part of the story, this was data collection, is data statistics. And statistics, I found always very curious to remind people that statistics, the word statistics, come out from state, from nation, from state, because at the beginning it was conceived as a way to collect and analyze data about the state in order to tax people. Once more, you know, taxes are always at the heart of our life, for bad or for good. And for many years, at the beginning, it was mainly a summary or descriptive statistics. So basically, there was not much behind it, because it was just a way to characterize large distributed data using average properties, like variance, other things which you learn in high school. The real revolution which led almost immediately to the foundation of what nowadays we call machine learning, took place in the 17th and 18th century, when the probability theory transformed the statistics into statistical pattern recognition. And there are many players in this story. So the first player I always like to quote this guy is Gerolamo Cardano, one of the most incredible people ever existed. He was born in Pavia in Italy in 1501. He was a polymath. He was a physician, he was a philologist, an astronomer, a biologist, also an astrologer. At that time it was possible to be both an astronomer and an astrologer. But mainly he was a mathematician and inventor, and look at this, he had also some problems. He was a gambler. He first believed in witches, so he was a great supporter of witch hunts and burning witches on the stake, which is not very nice. And he was also a gambler. He was an inventor. He has invented the combination lock, which you use nowadays on your trolleys. He invented the gimbal, which is that suspension you see here in the middle, which is the 3 degree of freedom suspension, which is used by gyroscope or stabilized surface, and even invented the cardan shaft, which was used in cars. So quite a genial guy. He was the first one to systematically use negative numbers. At that time they were quite new, and he, you know, made public, it was not to be discovered, but he advertised very much the solution of other mathematicians for cubic and quartic equation. He also understood the need for imaginary numbers, and this is really quite extraordinary achievement. But what is more important, in order to make good prediction for his gamble, he invented probability theory. He's the guy who basically invented the binomial coefficient and the binomial theorem, which are a little bit, you know, the foundation of probability, and also he started with the first theorem of probability. So it's nice to see, you know, that everything starts either from taxes or from gambling. Not really positive, but very. I find it quite fun. It's the next guy. I mean, then there is a long succession of scientists establishing this new field, which we nowadays, since, you know, in the modern world we like to put a label, and we have a sort of schizophrenic attitude toward the things. I mean, we like to fragment our knowledge, you know, in domains, and the narrower they are, the better it is, because this satisfies our need for control. But actually, I mean, I find very difficult to establish boundaries between, you know, any aspect of human thinking. But so nowadays we call these things statistical learning or statistical pattern recognition or machine learning or, you know, data mining. At the end, basically everything goes back to these people. We had Blaise Pascal, who made some important theorems about probability theory, then the Swiss Jacob Bernoulli, then Abraham de Moivre, was one of the most unknown mathematician, but he also is the one who established some very important mathematical theorem of probability theory, which enabled of estimate probability distributions. And then Thomas Bayes. I think that most of you have heard at least once Bayesian approach, Bayesian statistic, Bayesian Bayes theorem, and so on, is a very accurate way to infer knowledge out of data, a good way to extract information from data in presence of partial or negative information. Actually, Thomas, I never understood why the bias theorem is called bias theorem, because he had a very, if you read this paper, he has a very vague, vague understanding of what he wants to say. Then this guy here, Richard Prince, was the one who began to put Thomas Bayes' ideas in a more formal way, but the real inventor of statistics was an astronomer, I must discover that. Pierre-Simon de Laplace, one of the most influential astronomers of his time, he took the intuition, the very rough intuition had by Bayes, and developed it in what nowadays is known as the Bayesian theorem, and he established the Bayesian statistics. With the foundation of Bayesian statistics, we are basically beginning. So it's already the beginning of the 19th century. It was in 1805, if I'm not wrong. We have all the bricks which are needed to do statistical pattern recognition, which is one of the main aspects of machine learning and data science. So these tools, these algorithms, these mathematics have been around for a long, long time. Then what has changed is the way we implemented it into computer. But we'll go there we'll go back to this in a quite short time. Now, another gay guy is Carl Friedrich Gauss, who contributed a very important piece of information, you know, because basically he's the one who established the theory behind the regression and logistic regression, which are, for everyone who works in machine learning, are very too familiar terms, but the mathematics behind them was established by Gauss in the attempt to find the elements of the orbit of Ceres. Ceres had been discovered by Piazzi on the 1st of January 1801, and Carl Friedrich Gauss solved a very difficult problem of finding the orbital elements of a new planet using only three observations, and in doing so he invented the least square method, the method of the minimi quadrati, which is its most common tool nowadays for population of data, and in doing so he established the theorems behind linear regression and logistic regression. So basically at the beginning of the 19th century all the bricks were in place. Then there was a long time of quiescence. In the meanwhile there were significant advancements. For instance, nowadays there is a lot of talking about the data visualization, advanced data visualization, which is correct. I mean, it's a fitting field. But again, the problem is a new one. Everything started actually with this guy here, almost unknown to most people on Playfair. He was an English engineer who was working for rail companies, and he developed the statistical visualization. He is a guy who invented the area charts, the line charts, the time of histogram shown in the bar charts, the pie charts, all the tools which you use nowadays and which somehow have led to the field of mathematical visualization, which then is moved into the advanced visualization we use nowadays in computers. Obviously, things have changed a lot thanks to the introduction of computers or monitors. Here you can see, modern visualization of complex data, which would have been impossible for time. But remember that in most cases, more complex does not mean deeper. It's just that you are using old tricks to solve new problems, and you have a much larger computer power which allows you to do much more complex tasks, but, you know, not much new under the sun, I would say. Then there are exceptions. For instance, you know, you can visualize things in many different ways, and I think Jess remembers our first experiment in Second Life. George, Raffaele, Cipono, like myself, you know, were, you know, using Second Life to visualize complex data inside the temple. But, you know, no, there is not. And I must tell you that this is something which should go into the curriculum of Second Life, is that Ciro Donald and George, you know, experimented on in Second Life, have kept working on it, but basically using the same philosophy which was behind that visualization of life. And Ciro, as Ciro Donald, has started his own companies, which is now, say, nowadays one of the leaders of advanced visualization in the world, which is analytics. If you Google it, you'll be impressed by what he can do. Well, basically, he combines what he tested in Second Life with virtual reality, augmented reality. He uses HoloLens, Oculus Rift, and so on, you know, to allow you to interact with it in a complex environment. And this is, I like to say that this is a spin-off of research done in Second Life 10 years ago or more. Okay. Third piece of the brick of the wall is everything. Basically, the mathematics was in place. There has been not too much innovation in it. Also, all the emphasis which has been recently put on deep learning. Deep learning has been around for the last 20 years. They were called ensemble learning and so on. The only thing is that now these networks, which were awfully slow when you were running them on single processors of the previous generation, now can be run in the cloud on a huge amount of data, and obviously they lead to obtaining results. But I mean, in deep learning, there is nothing new. This is something which is seldom spoken out loudly. Google has invented nothing. All the theory, all the mathematics behind deep learning was already in the machine, in the data mining literature 20 years ago. They just, you know, optimized the algorithm. They invented specific subparts like adversarial networks, which, you know, but solve specific problem. But behind deep learning, there is nothing new with the exception of a huge amount of computational power. So the revolution started, this is just for historical reason, with Alan Turing, who invented the first computer, and things, you know, exploded after that. This is again a slide from a previous presentation. Nowadays, it is estimated that there is at least one processor every. So we have a huge amount of processors, and we have a huge amount of computing capability, especially if you connect this processor with the network, cloud computing, and things like that. Ah, two other people which I really think are always overlooked, I mean, were really instrumental to what is happening today, are the Todd Shannon, who really is the father of modern information theory, and also his theorem, the Shannon theorem, is at the center of, he was an American citizen who published a seminal paper, a mathematical theory, of the sources or whatever happened after. And then this lady, who is really very unknown to most people, Evelyn Fix, and their student Joseph Forges. Well, Evelyn Fix, already in 1951, we are talking about 68 years ago, invented the KNN, the nearest neighbor method, which nowadays is one of the most used things in data science. And one thing which I really am sorry for is that nowadays the way science works, which today, I mean, I'm an old guy, I'm 62 and I have business for 41 years now. And when I was young, people read literature. Nowadays, with the attitude of modern science, which is publish or perish, basically, you have to publish. It doesn't matter whether you publish good thing or bad thing, you have to publish because it's based on the number of kilos of papers you have published. Even if that paper is worthless, doesn't matter. So basically, people publish. They are in a hurry to publish. Basically, they don't spend the time in reading, they don't spend time in thinking very often. And what happens is that, for instance, PhD students or young researchers do not read any literature which is older than 5 years, at most, not usually 3 years. So you find nowadays that the nearest neighbors is attributed to some young, no, not so young, but to some American researchers who republished 10 years ago, and the name of Evelyn Fix is virtually unknown, but I invite you to read the papers for those of you who like these things. It is the nearest neighbor. She invented it completely, and she has never been acknowledged for it. And she's rightly to be considered one of the founder of modern science, or modern data science. The term artificial intelligence has, from a scientific point of view, at least, intelligent robots have been in the science fiction since 1852, so. But it comes out of a meeting, like, you know, another thing which is surprising, this innovative word, this buzzword, always come out from meetings. Like, for instance, the famous Drake equation, which is used very often to estimate the number of extraterrestrial civilizations, the probability that some extraterrestrial civilization is in the universe. You know, Drake equation and artificial intelligence come out of workshops, of the planning for workshop, or out of, in the case of the Drake equation, it comes out of the name of the session of the first meeting on the search for extraterrestrial. There is nothing scientific. It's just, you know, a sort of summary of the session or workshop. This guy, John McCarthy, one of the amazing mind of this century, is also Turing Medal, is inventor of the Lisp, is Chicago. In 1955, proposed to National Science Foundation a workshop to analyze the possibility to teach to computers or to program computers to perform tasks which at that time were considered to be an exclusive prerogative of the human. And in that paper, for the first time, appeared the word artificial intelligence, and with co-authors of the proposal were Klaus Schanz and Marvin Minsky at Rochester. If you read, his motivation is quite impressive. This guy then moved ahead. I mean, he invented the first language for this type of application, which is Lisp. Then he contributed to Algol. I mean, he died a few years ago, but he has been active the last minute of his life. Quite impressive guy. Okay, so let's go back to the beginning. So basically, I mean, it's a long history. There is, as it always happens in most of human endeavors, there is no discontinuity. There is a slow evolution toward a better understanding of what's going on. And then suddenly in 2015, as I said before, artificial intelligence emerged from a specialist domain from the science fiction to a very common phrase, very common word. So, why? Well, I think that now it brings back to the fact that for the first time, four things which have no intelligence whatsoever together. I mean, big data have no intelligence, no intrinsic intelligence. Computer networks, well, less than less. Computing intelligence is just a set of algorithms which are doing what I've been telling you so far, and they are also not intelligent. Let me. My dog is order of magnitudes algorithm. And then by intelligent human-machine interfaces. All these four things together conspired to make the word artificial intelligence credible. Now, it's important for me, and I am not a solution. I mean, this is an old slide. I am not a solution for this problem. To understand who really is behind the wheel. I have my suspicion, but I'm not saying that we are not going toward, in a far future, toward an artificial machine. I mean, it will, artificial intelligent machine. It is possible. It's feasible, it's just a matter of complexity. Will take long, probably, because at the moment we are beginning to understand. It will take, you know, the convergence of many science, biology, biotechnologies, machine learning, and computing and computer science there. But it's still far to come. So why suddenly artificial intelligence has become so popular? The data. There is a huge amount of data. And I know that now I'm going to repeat something which I said last year, but I want to say it in a different way this time. Because I have a different perception of the whole scenario. Artificial intelligence is, in some sense, emulated in specific tasks, which still have some algorithmic complexity behind it. But they are still in some way deterministic. They are still algorithmically defined by algorithms, by well-defined sequences of commands. For instance, computers now usually beat humans, you know, in chess playing, or, you know, even in television quiz like Jeopardy. They drive cars, they land planes, they land probes. But if they have very complex problems with some amount of indetermination, but everything is coded through algorithms, to a very smart exploitation of data collected by humans. And the algorithms are written by humans to emulate that specific behavior of their brains. So it's something very different from what we all envision as artificial intelligence. The problem is that this revolution, for the first time in the history, is not led by, not controlled by government. For anarchists, this can be good news. But, for humans who believe in democracy, I don't think that this is really good news. And I think that also the sudden increase in the usage of the term artificial intelligence comes out, and also the emphasis on the fact that artificial intelligence is coming, artificial intelligence is behind the corner, comes by reasons which have very little to do with the science. Total investment in the infosphere, where infosphere is a name invented by the director of the Digital Ethics Lab in Oxford, Floridi, Luciano Floridi, is a complex of net plus infrastructure plus software. Basically, it is 1,000 giga, $1 trillion in less than 10 years. A column of $100 bills, which goes from the Earth to the Moon, give an idea of the amount of money which has been invested by government and states. Then you find that the largest company existing in this moment in the world, the three companies which have gone beyond the $1 trillion of corporate value are Apple, Google, and recently the Chinese giant Baidu. They are all related to the data. If you see, this is the Google Galaxy. At some point, Google pays... I need to change my position because I cannot see something. Just a second. We work. Okay. I cannot read the number because my label falls. Okay. Pays $1.65 billion for YouTube and pays $19 billion every year to control the traffic on the apps on Android. Now, one thing which is very often, let me go ahead for a second, then I go back to some consideration. Then look, for instance, at Facebook. 200 billion users, so basically million users, so basically 2.2 billion users, which the same Zuckerberg calls the useful idiots. This man means something. And has a value of $700 billion, and has bought for Instagram for $741 million with only 20 million users, while has paid WhatsApp $19 billion with 1.5 billion users. Microsoft, $800 billion values, 1.5 billion users, buys Skype paying $8.5 billion for 633 million users. If you look at it, you see that there is a direct correlation between the number of users and the value of a society, and also the fact that these people are trying to create conglomerates which monopolize the data. Okay, why are they useful idiots, and why it is so? Where does this value come from? I like this picture because here to see useful idiots usually is used in an ironic way, but here you see real idiots providing big data to the big data provider, you know, while driving, while crossing a street, or while in the classroom. These are the traditional idiots which we all are used to, those who have existed since the Babylon time, you know. But for Facebook, for Zuckerberg, all users are useful idiots because basically they provide the data for free without realizing the huge value which is associated to this data, which they are providing for free. And this is also why these people rule the world. I'm getting close to the end because I see that they run for a long time, but it's in 5 minutes I'm done. So basically what is happening in this day is that at the beginning, there was a network. The network had the early web had information in it. This information had to be found. In order to find it, few companies built the first browsers. These browsers were exploring the net continuously to indexing the contents of the network, so that, and you had, you know, the first Safari, before that Netscape and many other browsers. Then Google came among these many players. In order to store the information, you need to build infrastructure. In parallel, in order to index this information, you need efficient algorithms for machine learning, you know, which basically go through the information that has been found on the network, you know, a call, and convert it in keywords which can be indexed and then searched by the browser. And in order to do this indexation, you need computing power. So at the end, what happened is that by chance, the people who started the first browser almost as a game found themselves in a virtuoso loop, basically in a spiral. More nodes in the network because there were more users, there was more information to be indexed, needed more storage for the indexation and more efficient algorithms for their understanding and classification. In order to dissolve, these companies needed to acquire larger infrastructure and so on. So before the governments could realize what was happening, these people became the monopoly of the game. They basically became the owner of the infosphere. Now, where does their huge richness come? The big data provider, you know, BDP. Nowadays, they own the world, basically. They are by far more powerful than any company, than any large international conglomerate of companies. They really own the world. Their power comes from the data, but not because many people mistakenly believe, you know, the data used to sell advertisement. Not at all. The advertisement revenue for this company is basically peanuts. I mean, you want to advertise a new type of shoes, okay, you pay $1 million. It's noise for these companies. Where does the richness come from, the value of this company? By the fact that they can use the information they have in their data set to exploit the society around themselves. So basically, they can sell this information to companies in order to improve their market. They can sell services for specific topics and so on. And this situation cannot be reserved. Now, since these companies are behind this machine learning and artificial intelligence, you realize that the main drive behind the sudden success of this artificial intelligence wording is related to the role which the data provide and conquered and very careful not to lose in the normal world. I mean, well, I'm sorry that it took longer than foreseen. There are many other things which I would like to see, but as a lapse, so I would like to finish here. If there is any question, any plan for a second part of this talk, I'd be very happy. So, let's finish here. I don't see any reaction from the public. There is. Oh, here we are, the chat. Okay. Thank you very much. I'm always glad that we have such an audience. Do you have any question? You know, I always found that the three laws of robotics are not really believable, because I think that, let me put things like that. Asimov was writing this thing in a racist era, basically, when there was still the understanding that some types of humans or some races were better than the others. I'm not saying that he was a racist, but basically he was not. But the culture of that time was permeated by this behavior. So basically, he created a sort of artificial intelligence which has no freedom or choice. Basically, he created the slaves. The robots by Asimov are intelligence with the limited range of activity. And this was basically, these three laws are dictated by the fear that humans have toward people who are different. The same reason why we have racism, you know, again, the people coming from other countries in the United States against Mexicans, or, you know, they are different. Everything which is different creates fear, and we need to build walls. In the case of Trump in Italy, we need to keep them away from the coasts due to Salvini, or, you know, in the case of Asimov, you need the three laws who are needed to protect humans from robots. I think that an artificial intelligence will be exactly what the name says. It will be an artificial intelligence. She will not care at all about any laws we can put in her brain, just because it will be intelligent, it will be free, it will be able to decide by itself. But this is just my personal belief, you know, belief. Oh, this is a long question and I have to read it. Just a second. You want my sincere answer? I think that unless we do something, and we do it at the governmental level, and unless we recover a sort of popular control, state control on big data and on the usage of this big data, we are bound to lose our freedoms, our civil rights. And basically, we are going toward one of the worst forms of dictatorship which human being has always experienced. Also because, remember, states, right or wrong, dictators, non-dictators, somehow wants the good of their subjects. Private companies, no. Mark Zuckerberg doesn't care about your well-being, doesn't care about the freedom of society. Only thing he is interested in is profit for his company. So for sure, if we leave big data and the ongoing revolution in the hands of big data providers, we are bound for the form of tyranny. I cannot read, sorry, yeah. Horrible prospect, I agree with you, yeah, definitely. But, I mean, it's, you know, usually I'm a very anti-government person, but in this case I would say that government have no responsibility for it. I mean, governments are things which react very slowly, and the evolution in this field was very quick. Basically, they were found unprepared. They had no time to react. And now the situation is rather bleak because the control of the data, the control of their distribution, of their usage is in the end of in the hands of a few tycoons who are not subject to any form of control. And this is scary. Well, I lost the full Sottolino. I can comment on that. I mean, there is a clear nursing later. Sorry, I'm having problems with this computer. Okay. Yeah, there are many, many studies about the way robots should look like, you know, when they, if they must look like human beings or not look like human beings. Now, to tell you the truth, I have no personal idea about that. I mean, the thing is still far away in the future, but people adjust to everything. I mean, so I really have no answer. I think there is a problem behind it, but really I have no answer about that. And so basically, no answer. I don't know. A comment to Taglin. Taglin, I do not agree with you because the motivations behind the government, you can, you know, I am a Democrat. I don't like, you know, many of the Republican ideas. I mean, the equivalent in Italy. So basically, in Italy, I'm on the left side of the world rather than on the right side. I don't like the right side of the world. But history teaches us that government, even wrong governments, can always be corrected. We had fascism and we took it down. There has been communism and we took it down when it didn't work. The problem is that, let me put things, a wider scenario, but now we go away, well, I move from the field of science to field of opinion. I think that one of the worst problems nowadays is that the advent of big data artificial intelligence is taking place in a vacuum of ideologies. In the past, basically, for the last two centuries, human beings have been driven by three dominant ideologies: fascism, communism, and liberalism. Fascism was basically taken care of by the Second World War, and we were left with communism and liberalism. Communism has been taken care of, like it or not, by the wall, when the Berlin Wall came down, and liberalism has been taken care of by the crisis in 2008. So for the first time, we are facing an epochal change in society, an epochal revolution in society without any ideology. And this is terrible. Because if you don't have ideology, you don't have a path to follow, you don't have goals. You don't know what you want as a society, where you want to go, and how to achieve it. And therefore, we are even in worse conditions. So in my opinion, it's very different to have a bad usage of technology or things from a government or from a corporation. Governments can be somehow controlled and corrected. Corporation not. Thank you. I also must go because for me it's dinner time. For me it's very late actually. It's 8:20 p.m. In any case, I mean, if you wish, I can give the second part of this talk in, let's say, in near future. I leave to Chantal and Jess to decide. Thank you very much to all of you. It was really a pleasure to be here. Have a good night or a good day according to your time zone. And most importantly, a good weekend. Ciao to everybody.
Thank you.